Last time, if you remember, we have completed with some sequence types. So we completed lists, we did tuples and dictionary. Today we are going to see sets in Python. Now you already know what is a set in mathematics, right? Mathematically, a set is just a collection of items, okay? And they are not in a particular order. Similarly, in Python, we have set, which is similar to the mathematical definition of sets. But there are some additional conditions which is followed in Python. Now, what are those? The first condition is the elements in the set cannot be duplicates. Okay? So you need to have unique elements in sets. Secondly, the elements in the set are immutable. That means it cannot be modified. Okay? But a set in a whole is mutable. The element is not mutable. The set as a whole is mutable. Please understand this. Then there is no indexing. Okay? As there is no index, okay? So we cannot do indexing and slicing operations on sets. So these are some few points or some few conditions that has to be followed when we are operating sets in Python. Now, how do we declare a Python? Okay, there are some operations, like everyone knows, sets are basically used for mathematical operations like union, intersection, differences, and complements, and so on. Okay, let us take an example, and we'll create a set and check how to display it. Okay. Now, while creating a set, we also make use of the keyword set here. Okay. So I'll declare one variable. Say we have days equal to, I use the keyword set here, into the round brackets. Okay. And inside the square brackets. Please remember, I'm using the function set. And inside the round brackets, the set function, we need to give the square bracket and then the elements. So let us say we have the elements, say days of the week. So I'll put Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Okay. Each element is separated by a comma, like we did in the other sequences. All the elements, remember, has to be separated by a comma. Now, this is one way of creating a set. We can also create a set by using the curly brackets. Okay. For example, if I, yes? Any doubts? And I'll go ahead. If I want, I can create another, say, set using the curly bracket. If you remember, when we created a dictionary, in that case also we used curly brackets. But there is a difference between the set and the dictionary. In dictionary, we have key and value, which is separated by a colon. Whereas in case of sets, we need to directly give the elements which are separated by just your commas. Okay, so I'll create some elements for the set. Let us put the months. I'll just put some few of them, say Feb, and I'll put March. Okay, so even this creates a set for you. Now the third and the last way of creating a set, if you want, you know, it can be a combination of string and numerical values as well. So I'll create one numerical set. Let us say dates, okay, equal to, I'll put some values here, say 21, 22, and some value, say 19. Okay, let us print this and check how it displays the sets. Okay, I'll display the days. months and the dates. Okay, let us execute this. Okay, as you can see, your set is actually displayed in curly brackets. Even if in the first statement, line number 8, where I had used the function set, inside the round bracket, I have given the elements in the square brackets. While displaying, you can see it has been displayed in curly brackets. One more thing you can notice is the order in which I have assigned the elements in my code is not similar to the one which I'm getting in my output. Okay. This itself indicates that it is not indexed and it is not in a particular order. Clear? So the order is not fixed in case of sets. Please remember this. Now, if I want to access the elements from the set, let us write a for loop for that. So if I want to display all the values from days, let us say for d in days. Okay. Followed by a colon, I can write the print statement, the print function. I'll write d. Okay. And if you want, I'll give a comma and let us complete this here and run this line. Okay. So what I'm doing here, I'm using the for loop. I'm using my in operator to access each element and go to the next element one by one and display it. Okay. When I run this, you can see I'm getting the values Monday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Tuesday. Fine. So this is in a different order as you can see it. The values which I have assigned was in a different order altogether. Now, can I add items to my sets? I can using a function called add. So if I want to add something, I can say days dot add. So add is a function which can be used here. And let us say I want to add a value in this. Let us say I want to add Sunday again. Okay. And then print it. Remember, I told you something as some properties I told you at the beginning for sets. And that the elements in sets should be unique values. Okay. So if I run this line, I run this, okay, and I execute. Here you can see in the list, this is my actual list. Okay, now Sunday was already there, and that's the reason it is not added Sunday to my set. Okay, you can see duplicates are not allowed at all. So the items remains unchanged. But if I want to add something like the full word Sunday, like this. Okay, let me run this line now. Okay, and now display it. Now you can see Sunday has been added here. Okay, so if you try to add an element which is already present in my set, it is not going to get executed or it's not going to add it up, right? It will remain unchanged. Neither you are going to get any error. Okay, there is no error, but remember, it is not going to add any duplicate values. Now let us see how to remove an element. So the element which I have just added Sunday, I'll remove it from the set. So I'll use days dot discard. So here's my function discard into round brackets, the element which I want to remove. Okay. And I'll print the set again. So let us execute this line, okay, and print it as well. Now, as you can see, my element Sunday has been removed from the set, okay? So these are some few basic two important functions you can see, how to add element to the set and how to remove an element from the set. Now, as I told you, the basic purpose of using sets are your mathematical operations such as union, intersection. Okay, let us see how to do that. Now I'll create two different sets. Let us say I'll write D1 equal to set into round bracket, then comes the square bracket, and I'll create only some values, say Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Okay, I'll create one more set by the name D2. This time I'll use the curly brackets. So I have the Wednesday again. And some other days as well, I'll add it up. Okay, and Saturday. This much is enough, I think. Fine. Now let us perform union. Okay. If I want to get, as you know, union means what? It'll take all the elements from both the sets. Okay. And if there are any elements which are like repeated, for example, in D1 and D2, if you look at the values, Wednesday has been repeated. Okay. So what happens? The common elements or the unique elements from set D1 plus the unique elements from set D2 plus the common element all together will be displayed. So let us write all days equal to, okay, because I'm using all days, I'll add Sunday as well. So all days equal to D1, okay, and there's a pipe sign here which is used as a union D2. Okay, so D1, the pipe sign D2, and let us display the values which are there in all days. Okay, so I'll start executing from line number 24. Let us run this one, no error. The second one, then I go ahead and perform the union. Okay, and now I display all the values. Now if you look at the values, Wednesday is not repeated again, okay, because it is common between both the sets. Fine. What is the other operator? Set operator is the intersection operator. Okay, so let us do intersection as well. So I'll use D3 now. I'll say D3 equal to, okay, D1, and for intersection we make use of the ampersand sign, okay, the and sign followed by the second set. Okay, let us display what we get in D3. I'll execute line number 30 and we display the value in D3. Okay, and as you know, Wednesday is the only element which is in both the sets, so I get Wednesday as my output. Clear? Now there's some subtraction or differences which we can find out. Like your minus operator can be used here. I can write D3 equal to D1 minus D2. Okay. What will this minus operator do? It is not going to perform any subtraction. Please remember the arithmetic subtraction. Okay, it is simply going to check both the elements, both the sets with the elements, and display the value which is not there. So you can see from D1 it is subtracting Wednesday and I get only the two elements, Monday and Tuesday. Okay, so whenever you want to eliminate some common element from the first set, if I change this sequence, if I change this to D2 minus D1, what will happen? From D2, Wednesday will be removed and I'll get the rest of the four values. So let us execute this one. And here you can see I got Sunday, Friday, Thursday, and Saturday. Okay, Wednesday has been removed from the set. Clear? So your minus or your difference between the two set, we can make use of the subtraction sign or the minus sign. Okay, we can also compare the sets. Like we already have two sets here, D1 and D2. Let us compare it I can write, let us write subset, okay, equal to, now comparison operator, as you already know, are your less than sign, equal to sign, greater than sign, right? So I'll use less than. Let us check whether D1 is less than equal to D2. Okay. And print the value which is there in subset. So either it will give me true or false, depending on whether it is less or equal. Okay. So if you look at the values, now D1 has Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. D2 has more values. So this should be, like you can see, it is a part of this. Is it a part of this particular set? That means whether it is a subset of D2. That is what we are checking. So I'll execute this line, and then later on I'll also make some changes to D1 to check whether it gives me the right answer. Okay, it says false. Why it is false? Because you can see this Wednesday is there in D2, right? But Monday and Tuesday is not there in this D2. Let us change some values from here and I'll put Monday also here. So I'll put Monday. Okay. Then I'll put Tuesday as well. Right. So this becomes a full set now, D2. I'll execute D2 first. Okay. Then I'll execute this statement on line number 36 and then check it out. Now it says true. Why true? Now because D1 has all the elements, okay, which are also available in D2. Okay, so D1, that is Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, is available in D2, and therefore it is a subset of D2. Okay, you can also check the superset. So if I want, I can write say superset equal to, now in this case I'll check for D2 because D2 looks like I have more elements there. So if D2 is greater than equal to D1, okay, and again it is going to give me true or false depending on whether it is a superset. Okay, so let us run these two lines and check the output. Okay, so it says true, but then if it, suppose I put here, I remove something from here. Let us remove Wednesday. Okay, and execute this line. Come back to superset. Run this one, and now you can see it is false. Clear? So these are some few functions which are there for your set type. Okay. And as we do some mathematical operations later on while doing the programming, we'll see more functions in sets. Clear? If you have doubts, you can ask me now, or I go ahead with the date and time types. I'll just show you some few commands in date and time. The first thing you have to, I'll just create a new file. Okay. Whenever you're using date and time type, the first thing you need to do is you have to import a module called time. Okay. So there is a module by the name time. You also have a module by the name calendar. Okay. So whenever we want to access the month and so on, we'll be using the calendar. Okay, let us see time first. So I'm importing a module time, and let us display the time. Now under this date and time type in Python, there is something called ticks. Okay, ticks are nothing but your seconds, and seconds are in floating point numbers. They are floating point numbers. And they give you the time elapsed, you can say, from a particular date. That date is 1st Jan 1970, 12 a.m. Okay. It is a part of the calculation which is used. It is also known as epoch in case of Unix. Okay. And what happens is, if I, like, for example, if I write ticks equal to, okay, time dot time, okay, this is going to return me the number of seconds which is, you know, completed till today's date and time. So how many seconds are over from 1st Jan 1970, okay, and from 12 a.m. onwards. And when I print this, you'll see it is a floating point values. So let us execute this whole program. Okay. And as you can see this output here, I am getting some numbers here, which is a floating point number. And these are your seconds. Okay. You can convert this into a better type or a readable type, you can say, by using a different function, which is known as your local time. Okay. So if I want to display the actual date and time, okay, I can write, let us directly print it. So I'll print local time, or let us say local current time. I'll put a colon, and we'll be using time dot ASC time. This is my function which I can use to get the local time. Or if you want, you can also directly make use of local time. So dot local time. Let us see what it displays here. Okay. So I'll come down here and I'll execute this line. Okay. Now you can see this local time has been displayed. And there are total 9, you can say, fields here. Now it says it is a structure, right? It is a time dot struct time. First one is the year, followed by the month, okay? Then the day, the hours, then minutes, seconds, then day of week, day of year, and daylight savings. Okay, this is the actual structure. It is nothing but a tuple actually, okay? So in case of times, if I try to display the time using the function local time, it is going to display me the full structure or the full tuple of time, which gives me this 9 elements or 9 members of the tuple. Okay. If I want to give an output which is readable, let us say I'll write LT equal to time dot ASC time. Okay, into round brackets, time dot local time. I'm converting this local time and I'll pass the ticks here. So local times, as I've already created ticks, I can make use of that, or I can also write time dot time here. Okay, both ways it is fine. So either you use this function, or because I've already used it, this function, and stored the values in seconds in this variable ticks, I can make use of the variable ticks here. Okay. So even this is possible. This is fine. I'll complete the round bracket. And now when I display this value, so I'll print it. I'll say local time, colon, and now I'll use LT, the variable where I have the local time. Let us execute these two lines. First of all, let me check the tick first. I'll execute this line. Then I'll execute this one. And finally this. Now you can see it is giving me a better time. Okay. Which gives me Thursday, August 27th. And the time, the current local time, that is 12:15. And some seconds and the year. Okay. Now there are many functions which are available in this date and time. So when we actually use these functions, I just wanted to show you this one particular function. There are many other functions, like we have sleep is one of the functions. Then clock is another function which we can use. Okay. And there are n number of functions which are available with the time module. Okay. We, as I told you, we also have a calendar. So whenever we use the calendar in any of the programs, I'll be using the functions and I'll be showing them to you. Okay, we are not going to go much deep into this date and time. Okay, we are now directly going to jump onto functions in Python. So can I go ahead with functions today? Guys, can I go ahead with functions? Waiting for your answers. Okay, as you have already made use of some functions, the first function which we actually started with was the print function. Okay, the print function is your inbuilt function which is available in Python. And if you want, the user can also write their user defined functions. Now, a function can be said as a block of code which can be used multiple times. Okay, so whenever I have some requirement of that particular code, what I can do is I can just give a call to the function and execute that code and my work is done. I need not write the code again and again to perform that particular task. Now, there are some rules which are defined in Python. So the first rule is whenever you start writing the function block, you have to begin with the keyword def, D-E-F, okay? It is a shortcut for definition, okay? Followed by the name of the function. For example, let us write, I want to display some string. So I'll give a function name here, say print me, okay? Followed by the parenthesis. Now this parenthesis or your round brackets can be empty, or you can pass some parameters or some arguments to the function. Okay. After this, it is followed by a colon, which indicates the beginning of the function. So the next line, line number 9, will be nothing but the beginning of your code block. Okay. And by default, the first line is actually reserved for your documentation. Okay, your documentation string, you can say. For example, I can directly give double quotes and give some statement which indicates what this function is going to do. So I can write here, this function will print a string. Okay, this line, which is immediately after defining the function name and your round brackets followed by the colon, is your documentation string, okay? Also known as your doc string. Next line, I'll be writing my actual code. So I can give a print function here and I say, welcome to Python, okay? And it has to be terminated, or the function will terminate it by using the return statement. Okay, the return statement can be only a simple statement, or it can also have some expression, or it can also have some variable if you want. If you want to return a value to the main function from where we have called it. Okay, now let us see how to call this function. I can just write print me, round brackets, that's it. If I write twice, it is going to print twice, that's it. So let us run this one. Okay, here you can see twice I'm getting welcome to Python, welcome to Python. I've just called this function twice. Now let us pass a parameter here. So I'll give str here, okay, which is a string for me. Or let me give only s And in this, when I'm calling the function, I'll write hello world. Welcome to Python. Right? And instead of welcome to Python here, I'll just give the parameter which we have passed, that is S. Okay, and here I'm going to delete this one. Run this now. Okay, and you can see the string has been passed to this variable S. And when I print this, I get the output. It's very simple. Okay, let us see some more type. If this is a simple string which I have passed to this function, let us say if I want to pass a string or a list to this particular function. So how do I do that? And if I want to change this inside the function, okay, let me make a change here. Okay, and in the square bracket, I will pass some values, say 10, 20, and 30. Okay, so there are three values which I'm passing to this function. Or if you want, you can also create a variable, my list, okay, equal to, and you can write the values here and pass this variable. Okay, so both ways, either you pass the values directly or you can pass the variable my list like this. Both are okay. Now what happens is, it comes, all these values will be stored in the variable S here, and when I print this, I'm going to get this three values. Okay, let us run this again. You can see this three values are getting printed. It simply means that whether you are passing a list, whether you are passing a tuple or a string, okay, the values will be stored directly in this variable which is passed as an argument or a parameter. Like in the other programming languages, we need to specify the data type. We are not supposed to do that here. Let us check whether if I want to change a value, say I write S square bracket and say index position, we have 0 and 1. So for index position 1, I change the value to say 50. Okay, and then I print it. Right? I'll run this whole program again. You can see the value has changed and I got 50 here. But this is not the purpose of changing the value. I want to see whether if I print my list in my main function, whether this change which I've done in the function will be reflected here as well. Okay, so what I'm doing here is, I have passed this variable, my list, to the function print me. In this, I have made a change at index position 1. I have changed the value to 50. Okay, and I call this function, right? Once this is printed, as you can see, the value has changed here. But when I come back from this function back to my main function or main program from where I've called it, I need to check whether my value is still 10, 20, 30 or it is changed to 10, 50 and 30. Okay, that is what we are checking. So let us print, run this and check it out. Here you can see the both the values now are same. That means the parameter which I've passed is actually by reference and not by value. Okay, so in Python, remember this rule, whatever parameters you are passing to the function are actually passed by reference and not by value. Clear? Any doubts in this particular statement which I've made now? No doubts? Okay, now let us go ahead and print the values, or let us change this, and I'll create two parameters now. So I have name comma age. There are two parameters which I want to pass here. Delete this. And in the print, I'll write name comma name. So I'm printing the name here. And I print the age. Okay. And I do not need my name here. Let us write name equal to, or I'll directly call the function using the values. So I'll pass some name, say Atul, comma, and I pass 23. Okay, complete the round bracket. I delete this one and I run this. Okay, you can see Atul, simply I got the values Atul and age. Now there's one twist I want to show you here. Let us say I want to pass the number first. If I want to pass 23 first, followed by the string Atul, whether this is going to work. So this is not going to work here. Okay. If I want to do this, I need to make use of the parameter names. So I can write age equal to 23, followed by name equal to Atul. Okay. And now when I run this, okay, I'm going to get the right output. So please remember, I can, you know, interchange the sequence of the parameters which I'm passing, provided I make use of the names of the parameters while passing the values to the function. Okay. When we come next, we are going to still see more functions, the different types of functions which we can use. And especially if I want to return a value from a function, we'll see that. We are also going to see anonymous functions, how to create them. Okay. And how to have variable length arguments in functions. Okay. So that's all for today. I hope you have understood things and keep on practicing, and it'll help you in writing bigger programs when we actually start with machine learning.